Okay, recording now. So, continuing the discussion of pain to release, particularly, I really have got to complete Mr. Vaillant's categorization of defense mechanisms. So let's just jump right in. On the page, Wikipedia, defense mechanisms, down the page, there's the link. We're still trying to get a classification scheme of defense mechanisms. And I think what I see, his model I think is excellent, obviously not perfect. There's certain deficiencies, and the more you look at these things, the deeper understanding can get anyway. And so everybody is standing on the shoulders of the guys and gals, the researchers and founders before them, and finding more and more that's important to say. So we know that he has George Iman Vaillant with the four-level classification. Pathological, immature, neurotic, and mature. Pathological and immature look very much like chronic and periodic psychosis and are in the border between our pathological is straight in the personality disorder camp, which is traditionally called psychotic, which is includes hallucination and an inability to accord with consensus 3D space-time reality. And it's not simply, I don't want to. That mind can't. So some minds are so damaged, some people have been so traumatized from past life basis for current life, generally childhood trauma, that mind simply cannot do consensus reality. That person is wildly hallucinating, or that person broke certain astral coverings or etheric coverings, and the time-space sound floods into their head, their mind, and they're hearing voices and entities speaking to them, and they just can't stop it. There's a certain helplessness at the level one pathological. And that helplessness is chronic at level one, and it's periodic at level two. In level three, what's called neurotic, the conscious mind has greater stability. The functions of the conscious mind are significantly capable of being well and healthy, of moving that mind, of that person using their mind to become well and healthy. But they're somewhat consciously choosing not to. They're somewhat consciously, conscious mind-based, signing on to denial, you know, distortion, avoidance, deny, distort, and manipulate, as we said, some of the roots of what mental disorder pathology could be called. On the page on psychopathology, because we're trying to get a sense of what is psychopathology, then how can it be classified from a Western psychological theory perspective, starting with psychoanalysis and Freud and Anna Freud, then object relations. Then we get Vaillant and these other guys that are still sort of quasi-psychoanalytic, and then bring that into transpersonal psychology and understanding that, well, everybody here is operating under ignorance, avidya, Buddhist perspective. Most all of human beings here are repeating the density from the raw material, the 3D repeating. That's true. All of that equals lower triad blockage and inadequate green, blue, indigo. Okay. Putting that all together, we're trying to at least determine, I'm trying to present how these theorists classified, first they how they defined the origin of psychopathology, mental illness, mental disorder, you know, this stuff, how they defined its origin, how they define its nature, the nature of psychopathology or mental illness, how they classify it, and then how we can understand that from a Buddhist and raw material transpersonal perspective, right? So transpersonal psychology doesn't go anywhere near the raw material, actually. When I went to CIIS years later and gave a talk on the raw material, the basic conclusion from the audience of young whippersnappers was something like, oh, it's a very interesting paradigm. That's another interesting paradigm. And that's where they think of it, and that's the end of that. It's just another, it's just yet another curious paradigm to them. I think what the raw material points to in this integration is objective reality, no proof, of course, from what I consider the objective reality that I could determine is the nature of mind and path and development from a perspective of Buddhism and the raw material and transpersonal psychology, which brings them together somewhat. Looking through that lens at Western psychology and psychoanalysis, views of psychopathology, mental illness, and their classification. All right. So the lower ceiling of Western psychology is raised by transpersonal and raised further, I think, by integration of the raw material and a Buddhist, an early Buddhist Theravadan view or core principles of Buddhism. So from the page on psychopathology, their very rough definition, one of the rough definitions of psychopathology is the four D's: deviance, distress, dysfunction, and danger. Well, humanity always, you know, to the extent that all beings have not freed themselves from dukkha, everyone's always in distress of one level or another. In terms of deviance, you know, that's really just a social group determining, meaning this group does that thing and we call it, you know, the what they do over there, we call it deviant, but they themselves call it normative. You can see the limits of using that as a way of understanding psychopathology. But certainly, some behaviors and patterns of mind cause more distress, but they may also avoid distress and be pathological. So there's apparent non-distress that can be pathological, as well as obviously enhanced stress or distress that could be called pathological. So you see, it gets very subtle. And then there's dysfunction, and then there's danger. So certainly, bringing yourself danger, bringing yourself and being unable to work in the 3D space-time environment, not work for money, but make sense of things and interact with people, is critical. And the inability to do that is a sign that there's something wrong with that person. But I think the basic conclusion is there's a lot wrong with everybody here, or all of us are simply on the path, and all of us have seven chakra blockages and imbalances and distortions. Here we're looking at the far end of mental pathology in the 3D repeater population, the far end of mental pathology, psychopathology, in a 3D repeater population with a whole lot of negativity. The far end equals level 1 and level 2 pathological and immature defenses, which I would say are chronic and then periodic. It's their frequency and their intensity that distinguishes those two levels. The pathological is sort of chronically structurally damaged. The mind can't listen, can't think, can't see clearly, can't do certain functions that lead to mental health and lead to good relationship and lead to self-understanding. That mind can't do that because of the intensity of imprinted pain, let's say. So examples are psychotic denial, delusional projection. The second category, the second level, immature, is not as withdrawn as level one, but it involves a whole lot of making trouble for self and other. It's just that that mind isn't sort of perma-psychotic. It's quasi or occasionally psychotic, that mind. The soul is, you know, beyond it. But a heavily damaged mind goes to level one, and a significantly but not totally damaged mind goes to level two. And so let's look at that, the far end of pathology. And I really, really, I'm going to have to wrap all these up here because I want to get to catharsis and finish this series and get myself released. And so, pathological defenses level one, immature defenses level two, examples of the far end, psychotic denial, you know, in that a person can't see. They just, you know, the person who is raging and you say, hey, be quiet, calm down, just talk to me in a calm voice, and in a second they stop and the rage is gone and they look at you and say, I'm calm. And the next minute they can start raging. That's a very dangerous mind. That's a mind that doesn't have a sense of proper boundaries, actually, and also can heavily control and manipulate its own experience. And we can say that level one and level two, what are called the, you know, these extreme level defense mechanisms of a very of a heavily or a moderately damaged mind, or a significantly damaged mind and an extremely non-functional mind. A extremely damaged mind is significantly non-functional, level one. A quite damaged mind that is periodically functional and regularly pathological is level two. They're both associated with control. And you can say the intensity of the trauma is correlated with the intensity of the mental pathology, is correlated with the degree of a perceived lack of control of the person during the trauma, and then in their thoughts associated with thinking about the trauma afterwards. The extremity of mental pathology is proportional to the extremity of a lack of control in the person who is the victim or was traumatized or whose mind suffers such damage. And so extremity of defense mechanism, the two far end, top level or most disordered levels of defense mechanism being one and two, pathological and immature. The term immature is actually really poor because it's worse than it sounds. Examples are fantasy, projection, passive aggression, acting out. There are some people who do passive aggressive acting out that are very harmful and very unreceptive to dialogue. So, but in both cases, levels one and two, the intensity of mental damage, structural inability, mental function breakdown is correlated, I would say, with the degree of perceived helplessness, out of control-ness, lack of control, perceived non-auto-determination, sort of complete helplessness dependency, inability to get one to, for that person to have gotten themselves out of the pain and the trauma in the moment. And so we can see, you know, a child, an infant that is hungry and cold, strapped down, left to cry in a cold room with the light on, night after night, because the parents think that's child rearing. That child may well grow up super psychotic. Very common. The people who are, I mean, intelligence agencies love them, you know. government, the people who staff government, above government, they love level two, level one, and level two folks. Those are the perfect comrades or cadres for them, actually. So, because they're so wounded. And so at the emotional level, we speak of wounded. At the chakra level, we speak of blockage. At the mental level, we speak of distortion. It's chakra blockage equals emotional wounding, or is associated with emotional wounding, and associated with mental distortion. Mental distortions of self-image, mental distortions associated with interpersonality, meaning interpersonal, relationship, interpersonal relations. Mental distortions associated with view of self, view of world, view of universe, and a whole lot of distortions in their desire. Meaning, I need 3 cars, or I need a new car every year. That's, I guess, what? Called a mature defense? Very mature. It ain't mature from looking from the perspective of those beyond third density. So from the animal, humans look from the bottom up, but seekers see from the top down. Meaning, compare up, don't compare down. Compare up means compare to those beyond us, not compare to those more dysfunctional than us or the animals. So, levels 1 and 2, heavy emotional wounding, heavy chakra blockage, heavy mental distortion, associated with a heavy experience of lack of control, helplessness, with a very... the pain itself may not have been severe, but the catalyst may not have been that severe, but the experience fashioned in response to the catalyst is extremely painful and generally associated with a lack of control. And so levels 1 and 2 are basically a heavily damaged mind's attempt to establish control in one's life, in that life. And a control, it's very autistic. And so I remember in the 70s, right? I'm from New York City, watching secret footage of the psychiatric ward at Willowbrook. Willowbrook equals people very damaged, banging their heads against the wall daily. And horrible mental... The condition of psychology in the 70s was, institutionally at least, horrible. At least in New York. You can see that a little bit in the movie Born on the 4th of July. The Ron Kovic story with Tom Cruise. But levels 1 and 2, heavy emotional wounding, meaning really in pain. But so much mental distortion or chakra blockage that functions of mind associated with stable self-consciousness are disabled. So level 1, the write-up. When predominant mechanisms always severely pathological, 6 defenses, he put a list of 6 somewhere, permit one effectively, not quite effectively, to rearrange, according to one's delusion, external experiences to eliminate the need to cope with reality. Actually, this is a mind that cannot cope with reality and is creating a fantasy, living in the sandcastle in the sky, the neurotic building it, the psychotic living in the sandcastle in the sky because of an inability to cope with reality. That is a stable, chronic condition, not periodically, chronic. Pathological users of these mechanisms frequently appear irrational or insane. Hey. But it's chronic. Pathological defenses, overt psychosis, delusional projection, and a lot of persecutory, because the person really was persecuted or harmed. I mean, all of this is considered the result of very bad karma, by the way. Levels 1 and 2 are considered... I mean, the person who goes insane is considered the person who drove the minds of others crazy in past lives. And or the person who did a lot of violence to others in past lives. I mean, what do you think? Where do you think the abusers go? after they go to hell, after they have some wandering on the earth, after they come back to earth, or 3D, they end up severely abused, because that's the karmic return for what they dished out. That's what those operatives are looking forward to. So, no surprise, they have a persecutory imagery or theme to their delusional experience. I'm being attacked. Yeah, you are. You are. You're being attacked by astral entities and by your own thought. Because this is your return. Denial, refusal, meaning pathological denial. Not just, I don't see it, I don't think it's there. But, I don't know what you're talking about. You just shot that rabbit behind the house. I don't know what you're talking about. How dare you say such a thing? I don't know why you're always saying such things. I think you need some help. You know. This kind of thing. Very, very self-centered, or self-assured, is one style of psychosis. So, refusing to accept external reality because it's too threatening. Again, environment equals threat. Environment is danger. I needs continual vigilance, meaning to maintain this I, this very distorted sense of self. Continual vigilance and aggression is needed. So, the first and second levels are often quite aggressive levels of pathology here, defense mechanism. Defense mechanisms are the means by which pathology is maintained. So I use them interchangeably. So this is serious denial. And another example, resolution of emotional conflict and reduction of anxiety. Sort of. It doesn't really address deeper emotional conflict. It's just burying it. But it's not done consciously. The person can't help themselves in level one. It's chronic. Refusing to perceive or consciously acknowledge more unpleasant aspects of external reality as well as internal reality or their own behavior. So an inability to self-reflect, an inability to see certain things in the environment. And so this is when, again, this is chronic and psychotic or associated with serious delusionality. Level 2 and 3 don't have that. But you will see a periodic frozen mind in associated with denials that people feel are too painful. But that doesn't mean they're psychotic. Distortion, gross reshaping of external reality to meet internal needs. Well, this is a planet of gross distortion. So the vast sinkhole of indifference leads to a 90% repeater rate. So I think they know much about distortion. Level 2, immature and what I would call periodically psychotic. But you see, Mr. Vaillant is trying to... He's a little bit of normalizing pathology. And meaning, oh, well, it's present in adults, so it's not that serious. Well, it's, you know, bad or good, it actually can be quite serious. The psychopathology of defense mechanisms at level 2. Lessen distress, like all defense mechanisms. They lessen the anxiety produced by threatening people or by an uncomfortable reality. There are people who are not threatening that are felt to be threatening. There are realities that are not uncomfortable. Reality that is as it is and the person feels uncomfortable, you know, is there are certainly stressful environments and people break, the mind may break. But there's a whole lot of, you know, this is Wikipedia, so there's a whole lot of mixed levels of understanding, and even, you know, thinking straight here is very difficult. Threatening people. Well, some people are perceived as threatening, but they're not. But with this also helplessness associated level of defense mechanisms, there is a desire to gain some control, a sense of control or not being out of control. And in general, all, certainly levels 2 and 3, 4, are very much associated with a conscious sense of anxiety, or semi-conscious anxiety, discomfort. And the opposite of that is open-hearted willingness to feel, open-hearted willingness to see, open-hearted willingness to think and reflect and speak and listen and keep seeing and keep feeling and keep thinking and keep dialoguing. That's health, I'd say. And then taking appropriate action when there really is a threat or something urgent. Excessive use of such immature defenses seen as socially undesirable. They're immature, difficult to deal with, seriously out of touch with reality. Well, that's a problem, you know. That's worse than the word immature. Seriously out of touch with reality deserves the word pathological, I'd say. So-called, and so there's a little, you can see, Vaillant's trying to water down any kind of stigma associated with these higher levels of defenses. Overuse almost always leads to serious problems in the ability to cope effectively, yeah, and that's because they're periodic, while in the first category, they're chronic and the person really can't stop their insanity, right? They really, and that includes all sorts of other things, obsessive compulsive, paranoid, you know, bipolar, borderline, the whole thing. But that mind is somewhat out of control. In the second level here, there really is some conscious mind ability to manage the experience. And therefore you can appeal to will and free will. These defenses often seen in major depression personality disorders, right? So there are personality disorders that are amenable to treatment particularly means talking with somebody who understands and can help. And then there are conditions that are not amenable to anything but medicine, or, you know, so-called medicine, drugs, and they don't really help the person deeply either. It's a karmic mark for the whole lifetime in category one. They're not going to come back. They're going to die in that mental psychopathological condition, and that's a karmic return for this lifetime that we don't fully understand. So examples now, back to number two, of immature acting out, direct expression of unconscious wish or impulse in action. Direct expression without conscious awareness, meaning the person doesn't know what they're doing. They're doing without knowing, and only later they figure it out. Hypochondriasis, excessive preoccupation about serious illness, you know, and then you get to hand-washing kind of compulsions, a sense that I'm dirty, or I'm sick, I'm going to get sick, or I'm sick, I know I'm going to die, I know. Passive-aggressive, indirect expression of hostility. So you see, again, hostility is critical. There's a lot of hostility in this set. Aggression against hypochondriasis is a sort of self-punishing by assumed illness or assumed some kind of sickness that the person, or injury that the person assumes is coming or assumes they have. That's a kind of aggressive self-punishment, I'd say. Passive-aggressive is directs that anger to other. Projection. And it was a very interesting point here. It's written, a primitive form of paranoia. Meaning, primitive, meaning not under the control of the conscious mind. Automatic or instinctual. Paranoia is pretty primitive itself, meaning a belief in a threatening environment when it isn't the case. There are threatening environments that need to be recognized, but when the environment is not threatening, one projects onto it the belief that it is threatening. They're all out to get me. It's not much different than paranoia, but they're different kinds of projection. So written here, we talked about this before. Projection reduces anxiety temporarily, sort of, maybe, by allowing expression of one type of it is it allows expression of undesirable impulses or desires without becoming consciously aware of them. So you see, in these first two stages of defense mechanisms, there's also a big conflict between the conscious mind and the subconscious. The conscious mind is sort of felt like besieged by the subconscious. The subconscious besieges me. I'm like a knight in the castle on the hill, and all these arrows keep coming up, and all this stuff keeps coming at me from the subconscious, from the depths. And that kind of, there are a lot of people who have a lot of aggression and fear of their own subconscious. And you can say that any defense mechanism comes from an unhealed fear conflict with the subconscious. Projection, a misunderstood amplification, a false amplification of the power of the subconscious in the mind or the opinion of the conscious mind, meaning I'm afraid of monsters from the deep. There are monsters in the deep, you know. If I don't control myself, what's going to happen? I'll become a monster. Out of control. That's the worst. I can't be out of control. I've got to be in control. Meaning, the conscious mind feels besieged and set upon by the monsters from the deep. And if you hate your mind, yeah, it'll come back at you that way. So projection is very much associated with internal splitting between the conscious and subconscious. Now, obviously, there is, right? Cards 1 and 2, Matrix of Mind, what was the other one? Matrix and the Potentiator of Mind. So the subconscious really is distinct. It really does potentiate the matrix, conscious mind, which is unmoved, right? In fact, that's the point. And so now I can't get into it, but there is a metaphysical basis before the chakra blockage, mental distortion, psychological pathology of a serious split between the conscious and the subconscious, and the view that the subconscious has active monsters and I am a passive potential victim, potential, you know, target, conscious mind. Ross said, the conscious mind, the matrix, is unmoving, but the potentiator is moving. Meaning, there's a certain activity of the subconscious that is distinct from a non-activity or dwelling, a condition of dwelling of conscious mind. The conscious mind is like the eye that sees. That eye ain't jumping. It's not a jumping eye. It's a set eye, or two, or three, or 1,000. And so, the fixity of the conscious mind indeed is a metaphysical fact. And the fluidity, volatility, lability, how labile, of the subconscious, its activity, is real. And that's a metaphysical angle on the classification of defense mechanisms or pathology that follow an order of relative wounding of mental structure. The far end 1 and 2 has a seriously wounded mental structure or mental function. Mental functions coming out of wounded structure. Levels 3 and 4 are less damaged and more functional. But the most severe are very much associated with the reality of being out of control. You see, the conscious mind actually has very limited ability to control, because the subconscious is vast and active. The subconscious is time-space, too. The deep mind goes to the racial, goes to the planetary, goes to the cosmic. That's all in the subconscious. It's vast, and it's active, and it's powerful. And the conscious mind is unmoving. the eye is fixed in its location, or many eyes you have, one or two or three particularly. And in some ways, these levels of pathology show levels of the ability to cope with the very lack of control that the conscious mind has in 3D space-time. The conscious mind in 3D space-time, under the veil, is meant to not have certain control. It's meant to be a fixed eye that can see and know and choose and fashion, not control the environment, meaning not populate the environment, particularly the environment of mind. The subconscious is not populated by the conscious mind. The subconscious is autonomous, and the conscious mind may or may not feel very good with that. So it's a matter of how much love. It's a matter of love. So control, you know, love and control are opposite. And so inability to be out of control, a fear of exaggerated terror of feeling out of control, exaggerated sense of the potency of the subconscious, hypervigilance, it's written here, right? Hypervigilance to external danger, hypervigilance to internal danger. It's pretty serious. It called level two here, but it's pretty, it's quite pathological, psychopathological, to have a terror at one's own mind, fear of one's own subconscious. But that's what's going on in all cases here. And it's in some ways the inevitable weakness of the 3D under the veil space, 3D space-time veiled conscious mind. 3D space-time veiled conscious mind that is unmoving, as Ross said. Meaning the heavily populated, rich, active, potent, busy, vast subconscious. The mind that's very wounded, has a lot of emotional wounding, can't handle its lack of control well. The mind that has less wounding or has done more healing can handle its lack of control better. This is a very subtle point, actually, and I didn't think of it before I arrived here. But the need, lack of control and attempts to reestablish control are woven all through to every defense mechanism, and in a particular progression in these four levels of defense mechanism categorization. So finally, about projection as so-called immature second level, which it actually goes really quite severe. All with the aim of shifting one's unacceptable thoughts, feelings, and impulses onto someone else, such that those same thoughts, feelings, and beliefs and motivations, right? Thinking, feeling, and deep thinking is called beliefs, and desires are called motivations. So how I'm feeling, what I'm thinking, where that thinking comes from is my deep beliefs or core beliefs. That is associated with what I want, what I don't want, which is associated with motivation. So motivation comes out of one's core beliefs and way of thinking associated with one's feeling. But even the feeling, the feeling is not born by the catalyst. The feeling is a response to catalyst. And so the pain that every infant feels from inadequate parents or lousy mothering, which is the case, that's the standard down here. Each soul would be able to handle that lack of love or imperfect parenting or needs unmet or some trauma or violation or lack of love and attention and care. Each soul will handle that differently and fashion coping mechanisms, strategies in response to that of various ability, more or less loving and honest, more or less uncontrolling, non-controlling, accepting, and clearly seeing, love and wisdom, right? Acceptance and understanding. And so projection is very common and happens all over the place today. People blaming others for what they themselves are doing, or seeing in another what they don't want to see in themselves, and doing things without acknowledging their responsibility. So a whole lot of irresponsibility is also associated with projection, but it's also associated with all of these levels. The one that's acting out doesn't necessarily know why they are or that they are. They may think, I'm normal, I'm healthy, and all sorts of things. Passive-aggressive, the person will deny it. Then we have schizoid fantasy. Schizoid is not schizophrenic, but it's close. Tendency to retreat into fantasy in order to resolve inner and outer conflicts. And so there's fantasy and there's schizoid fantasy, right? There's healthy fantasy and there's schizoid or unskillful fantasy. And so again, there's skillful, unskillful. I don't know about passive-aggressive being skillful, potentially skillful, but sometimes saying less makes a bigger statement than saying more. Or one can cut with a glance and no words needed to put a fool in their place when they're bringing their folly to others. So there are skillful versions of defense mechanisms sometimes. But in the case of schizoid fantasy, it's called unskillful. And it's basically, and a lot of people are in this today. I mean, it's the hikikomori in Japan, the stay-home people who don't go out, and lots of people who stay in front of their computer 10 hours, 12 hours a day. It is possible to attempt to resolve inner and outer conflict. They're different. See, inner and outer conflict are different. But it's possible to do skillful fantasy. And that's similar to what Ross said in terms of experiencing those desires that might be harmful to self or other or infringing. Experiencing them mentally, imaginatively, to distill love light from them then. And move through that to a more mature level of desire or awareness. That's a skillful use of fantasy. Okay. Time check. All right, I can do 20 minutes here. Levels 3 and 4, neurotic and so-called mature. Neurotic is a line has been crossed when we go from categories, levels 1 and 2 to 3 and 4. 1 and 2 are deeper down in irreconcilable conflict between the conscious and the subconscious. Profound sense of out of control, lack of control by the conscious mind, of the conscious mind in the past, leading to the formation of those mechanisms. Significant inability to live in consensus 3D space-time reality. Here, levels 3 and 4, we're getting strengthened functions of mind, more stable conscious mind, more mental functions available, and what looks to me like a more significant conscious mind buy-in, sign-off on. Buddhism is called Chandra. I think it's called Chanda or Chandra. It's sort of the attachment to attachments. There's attachment to defense mechanisms. There is clinging to, cherishing, holding dear, kind of delighting in falsity to some degree. Meaning the person in the right way could be informed and would hear, yes, this is really what you're doing and you're making trouble for yourself and other. You're playing a little game here. You're in an avoidance fantasy, denial, distortion situation. In these two levels of mental functioning, the person could acknowledge it. Is more likely to be able to acknowledge, yes, you're right, I've bought into this, or I sort of hold it close and dear because it makes you feel better. So these level 3 defenses, short-term advantages in coping, while, you know, levels one and two have long-term fencing off of the ability to truly interact and get fulfillment, and so they're coping at the cost of relationship and any kind of deep well-being. But here we have some type of defense mechanisms in the category neurotic do indeed have short-term value and can be quite skillful, meaning can be used in a skillful way. Then they can be used in an unskillful way, often cause long-term problems in relationships, work, and enjoying life in the world of Kamaloka with the three poisons and the three marks. When used as a primary style of coping with the world. Right, coping by falsity, coping by control and dishonesty ain't too helpful. So the opposite of love is control, the opposite of honesty is dishonesty. These defense mechanisms are very much associated with dishonesty and control. Dishonest controlling, or controlled dishonesty. Self-controlling dishonesty. And not, and that's, you know, why you've got a planet of 90% repeaters. So, displacement. I'll just go through these quickly. This is, and there are many more than just these that are written. Defense mechanism displacement may be shifting sexual or aggressive impulses to more acceptable or less threatening targets. Separating emotions from the real object, redirecting of the intense emotion towards something or someone that's less offensive to avoid dealing with what's frightening or threatening. It's like I have a certain feeling or I have a certain need or desire and I can't accept that it is and I can't work with it, so I will believe that it's out there, not in here. It's a kind of projection, you can say. But there are other types of displacement that are more complicated than that. Seeing a part of oneself in a part of another or a situation, even. It's certainly projective, but there's a splitting. It's a sort of project. There's a splitting and a projection. Dissociation. So all of these are so complicated. I could just talk for hours on just the nitty gritty of each one, and I'm not an expert, so I'm just learning along the way. But they're very deep, and they happen all over the place. We see it. Dissociation, temporary, drastic modification of personal identity and character. It's a funky way of putting it. It's really it's a disassociation. It's a bad association or a severing of association. If it's temporary, it's in this level 3. If it's permanent, it's in level 1. Drastic, yeah, it is pretty drastic, but it's really a depersonalization. Depersonalization, there can be a spiritual depersonalization. It can be people can fall into things like this after meditation or a lot of spiritual practice. It's not just some drastic modification of identity. It's actually a removal of identification with mind. It's a temporary or permanent, temporary or long-term severance of the conscious mind's identification of itself and identification with the subconscious. Like, that ain't mine, that ain't me, I don't know what you're talking about. It looks like spaced out, it looks like autistic, it can go right to schizoidal or schizotypal, it can go straight into psychotic, and the person doesn't come back. And it's often a result of, or response to heavy trauma. You know, sexual trauma, depersonalization, dissociation is very common. Like, you know, he's yelling at me and then my eyes glaze over and I'm not listening. That may be a moderately skillful temporary dissociative condition. And the far end of that, of course, is the person's knocking their head on the wall 5 hours at a time. So this stuff gets really messy and nasty. Dissociation has a whole... All of these have a spectrum of pathology or severity. So, and then they even put separation or postponement of a feeling that would accompany a situation or thought. I wouldn't call that dissociation. So you got all sorts of... You got some grad students writing this. Intellectualization is basically... They wrote here a form of isolation. Very, very right. That's a very subtle point. To put it into the intellect to avoid the emotional isolates the conscious mind by the conscious mind identifying with the intellectual and rejecting its greater identity that includes the emotional. And so there are a lot of people, very smart people, who are like that, and they basically have dulled their emotional reactivity. They don't want to feel. And so they go into their head, and they may be brilliant. They may be great literary critics with thick glasses and their pen, and a nice pen. And they're always making new important philosophical statements. Not realizing how they're driven because of their insecurity and their sense of low value. Okie dokie. So there's all sorts of stuff in there that's associated with rationalization and then magical thinking and all sorts of things. Reaction formation, we talked about that. Putting things into their opposites and basically overcompensating in a self-deceptive way. Repression is just pushing it down. So it goes on and on and on. And when you go to level 4 and the mature level defenses... we have a whole other thing which includes Mr. Vaillant's political bias, perhaps, where he wanted what looks to me like he's saying that since lots of people do it, it's pretty normal. Well, it's mature. what a low balling of what maturity really is. What a low estimation of the human potential. These are signs of maturity. Oh, yeah? Really? So, 3D repeaters have no sense of where they're going, clearly. So, they're commonly found among, quote, emotionally healthy adults. This is humans have a very low standard for themselves. That's why they keep repeating. They compare down. So... You could be emotionally healthy, great, and you're going to repeat third density for another 50,000 years. Mm-hmm. But here, they're considered mature. Even if they have their origins in an immature state of development or an earlier stage, they optimize success in human society and relationships. So this is also a little bit of a cynical view, which has some truth to it, that people... are doing things to get success and avoid some pain at the same time. And get some success and avoid pain, and maybe even considered goodly people. But they're avoidant or operating out of defense mechanisms or sort of tricks in the mind, which are basically about dishonesty and control, to not see or feel or admit something or other about their process or their experience, and yet have bundled all that avoidance and kind of strategic, the need of a strategic approach to keep my mind under control. That's what we're talking about here. Into some socially useful or helpful or successful activity endeavor. And he said, those who use these mechanisms are usually considered virtuous. They help integrate conflicting emotions and thoughts, which is again done also at the second, third levels, while still remaining effective defenses. So he seemed to have put a positive spin on defense mechanisms. Because he doesn't know anything about fourth and fifth chakra, you say. He doesn't know what that is. He doesn't know what the heart of green ray, that there is a green ray to fully heart know, to fully heart know green ray, to fully mind know blue ray. He doesn't know that that's possible. So these are considered mature and virtuous, effective ways of operating in society that just so happen to also distort, defer, deny, push away some pain or anxiety, or do a little trick in the mind. So here he's calling altruism. So this could be called pathological altruism or conflicted. Here we're not really quite in the pathological, we're really in the conflicted category. This level could be called conflicted. While levels 1 and 2, level 1 could be called straight out psychotic, and level 2 would be called severely pathological. Level 3 could be called, level 3 could be called, the neurotic could be called, deliberately avoidant, deliberately manipulative. And so there's because the conscious mind is much more involved in level 3 than 1 or 2, where the conscious mind has more function. The conscious mind in level 1 is either extremely narrowed, cramped or isolated, or fused with the subconscious, or swamped regularly by the subconscious, or at total war with the subconscious, and also tiny and isolated. Level 2, the conscious mind has more function, more healthy functionality, and has a periodically dysfunctional relation to the subconscious. Level 3, the conscious mind knows what it's doing. The person could be called out effectively. Level 2, they often can't be called out. Level 1, forget it. Level 3, the neurotic, there is deliberate buy-in to manipulation, denial, distortion, and screwing around. The games are being played and the conscious mind ain't asleep to it. Level 4, you've got sort of a positive utilization of the conscious mind's gamesmanship on itself, in terms of how it manages the subconscious and feeling and stuff that's painful and scary, to possibly actually be a leading member of society. So there's true altruism. They call it altruism. I would call it that there's a distinction between true altruism, which is green-blue-indigo, and pathological or conflicted altruism. Constructive service to others that brings pleasure and personal satisfaction. There's nothing wrong with that. That doesn't look conflicted to me. But there are people, or some altruism, and very effective altruism, comes from self-hatred, low self-esteem, profound self-doubt, insecurity, or a sense of I've got to look good in my parents' eyes at last. This is conflicted altruism. And then there's fake altruism, of course. But true altruism, I don't think there's any pathological quality to it. Anticipation, realistic planning for future discomfort. Well, that sounds like wisdom. I guess there is conflicted or neurotic anticipation. You plan realistically, but you're partly living in a paranoid fantasy. You're realistically planning for something that will never come, not knowing and not willing to look at the realism that it'll never come. I guess that could be pathological anticipation. Humor, overt expressions of ideas and feelings. And particularly, he said, thoughts retain a portion of their innate distress. And that's, again, referring back to one of the D's, the D of distress. Yeah, all defense mechanisms come out of distress. However, all 3D repeaters are in distress, and all 3D harvest folks and all 6 density wanderers are in distress. Everybody in the octave is in distress. Did you know that? The whole octave is in distress. Like the guy home alone with his hands around his mouth saying, "Ooh!" Or Munch and the guy on the bridge. All being is in distress in the octave. All being is in dukkha, you know. All vijnana is colored by dukkha in 31 in Triloka. So vijnana consciousness, anybody's consciousness, any being and their consciousness has dukkha, stress, in the three realms, Triloka, of seven dimensions in the octave. So there'll always be distress available. It's a matter of how much distress and how and the relationship between the conscious mind and that distress. Distress cannot be removed, but it can be met with love and wisdom by conscious mind. So this is, you know, you've got kind of neurotic humor or Woody Allen, right? Self-deprecation. So certain groups, certain people, certain minds with certain patterns and avoidance and wrong belief do neurotic action through conflicted or confused humor. Sure. Sublimation, like needing sex but playing heavy contact sports such as football or rugby. Transforming aggression into a game. But you see, the people who do that are actually still aggressive. Generally. Not always. And then suppression. So you see that there are defense mechanisms that they themselves have a spectrum. So there is relatively skillful suppression, like a conscious decision to delay paying attention to a thought, emotion, or need in order to cope with the present reality. That's wisdom, I think, making it possible later to access uncomfortable, distressing emotions while accepting them. I wouldn't call that a defense mechanism. I would call that a wise use of mind, acknowledging that now my priority is to take care of a crisis, and later I shall address, you know, the metaphysics or my emotional pain. That looks very wise to me, not a defense mechanism. So he puts some qualities of true spiritual maturity, I'd say, here in this category of mature defense mechanism. So everybody's got their limits. So I think that's it. Sorry for the fast pace here. Next week I will do basically some final comments to summarize these four levels of defense mechanism from George Iman Vaillant, and how they reflect four different levels of capacity of the conscious mind to live with the subconscious. Four different gradations of the ability of the conscious mind to meet the subconscious with love and wisdom, or acceptance and understanding. And a sequence of comfort with lack of control of the conscious mind. How comfortable is the conscious mind with lack of control? The most comfortable equals most healthy. The least comfortable equals psychotic. And the most previously traumatically out of control leads often to the most severe pathologies, level 1 and 2. But distress is, you know, it's a matter of skillful or unskillful handling of upsetting, painful thought, feeling, belief, truth, reality, desire, all sorts of things. How careful, how, you know, skillful equals green, blue, indigo. Unskillful equals no green, blue, indigo, or lower triad blockage only. Unskillful equals meeting catalyst with lower triad blockage only. Skillful equals meeting catalyst with green, blue, indigo, as far as I can tell. So, boom, 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 boom. I hope that you had a good time. Thank you for listening. Next time I'll wrap up Vaillant's excellent contribution. I think this is excellent to work from. It's an excellent basis for further contemplation. And then we'll move towards catharsis. So, and then release. So, I hope you're well. Thank you for listening. I hope it's been beneficial. Take good care and good night.